today. All right, well, grab your Bibles. If you haven't brought them, it'll be up on the screen for you also to be able to follow around. But this morning with Mother's Day, just like we prayed a few moments ago, we want to make sure that we understand this is not just a message for moms. This is for moms, dads, those of us who aren't moms or dads yet, those who have gone past that, because I want you to understand something. Everybody gets to live a life of legacy. We're going to be talking about that legacy today. Somebody is going to say something about your life when your life is over. This morning, as we begin, I want to give honor, first of all, to my mother, who is here this morning. I thank God for a godly mother and all that she's meant for me. And the mother of my children, I saw my wife in here a moment ago. I know, there she is, all the way in the back, from my wife, who has been an incredible blessing. Us and to the church. You know, I was thinking of legacy, and one of the things that we did growing up, and how many of you like to go to Gettysburg and historical places, and you enjoy seeing that? Ah, some of you right in your mode. One of the things that we did at different places, especially historical places, is we would go in, and my mother especially liked reading old tombstones. You into that? Some people played with blocks and balls growing up. We read tombstones. No, it's I thought I would read a few tombstones to you, real tombstones that I found online. Listen to a few of these that actually exist. Here's the first one. She lived with her husband for 50 years and died in the confident hope of a better life. Maybe could have been worded a little differently, but a few aisles down, there was one that said this: "Here lies my wife. Here let her lie. Now she's at rest, and so am I." No, there's no saying it again to that one, brother. That's now, this is a literal one up in Unionstown, Pennsylvania, in memory of an accident that took place. And it says this: "Here lies the body of Jonathan Blake. He stepped on the gas instead of the brake." An old cowboy tombstone in Arizona says this: "Here lies Lester Moore. Took 4 slugs from a 44, no less, no more." This one, next one, could be part of my family. After it tells you who lies there, he says, "He was a good husband, a wonderful father, but a terrible electrician. So here he lies." Russ Dwyer, that could have been yours last week. That's, this one I hesitated whether to read or not, but I'm going to throw it out there for y'all anyway. It says this: "Ma loved Pa. Pa loved women. Ma caught Pa with 2 in swimming, so here lies Pa." Don't even say it again for that one. That's 2 more. Joel H. Cheskin, on his avid golfer, says this: "Finally, a hole in one." And then on Merv Griffin's tombstone, he says, "I will not be right back after this brief message." All kinds of things have been written about lives. Those are kind of brief synopsis, little funny sayings. There are other ones that I would not even read in a church, and you can look up online for yourself. They were written by folks who weren't very happy with the people who were in that grave at the time. But the reality is, all of our lives speak about something. Speaks about our beliefs. Speaks about our values. Speaks about what we held dear to our hearts. And you're known for various things in your life. All of us are going to be known. The reality is, one of the things that we ask, and we ask on a regular basis, is how are we known to our God? See, we might be known to our family in one way, might be known to our friends in a different way, you might be known at work in a certain way, but What does our life before God speak? I want you to know something this morning. Your life speaks of something. And let me encourage you in this first thought, because I'm going to give you just a number of different thoughts today as we go through the scripture. Sometimes when we break down people's lives like that, we say they're known for this way with their family. They're known to be this type of person at their work. They're known to be this type of person at their school. And sometimes when you get groups together and they begin to talk about a person, it's almost like it was a different person in each place. He lived one life with his family, lived another life with his job, lived another life at his school. And it's amazing. Have you ever been to a funeral service where someone gets up and speaks about the person lying in the casket and you nudge the person next to you and said, who's he talking about? You've been in those places before. That's, why? Because sometimes we've got so many facets of our personality and we're trying to live a life so that we fit in on our job and we fit in at our school and we fit in with our family and we still fit in with our church when we go to church. Can I share this with you this morning? We need to be a man or a woman of God that fits in with our God 24/7, no matter where we go, whether it's our family, our job, our school, that people look us and know us for who we are in Christ, not just knowing me, what I look like. What I look like on the outside can change every few years. Some of you know what I'm talking about. We look at that. I mentioned it last week. We look at the picture we have on Facebook, how we liked how we looked 10 years ago, and we leave that thing up there because we are in flat denial of how we look today. We say, that's the person that I want to be, and that's the person we were at some point in time, but we change. The outside of us changes. You know, the Bible says that inwardly we're being renewed day by day. We don't like the other part that says outwardly we're wasting away. But the mirror tells me the same thing the scripture does. It ain't getting any better on the outside. How many of you understand, for some of us, our glory days are behind us. It's only your glory days in your flesh. I got good news for you today. Your real glory days are still ahead of you. The best days are still to come. Oh, and that's not even going to be down here in this world. Listen, when you hit glory and you understand what it's really all about and we stop seeing through a glass darkly, but we see face to face, man, you're going to look at this and it is all going to be a blip of the past and you're going to think, I can't believe I spent so much time worrying about this and going through that, when the reality is it's all about Him and what He's doing through our lives. Amen? Amen. Sometimes we forget about that. And the good news is we're not the only ones who forget about that. This morning I want to read you a scripture from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. I'm going to use a portion of this. And this is a part of a letter. You know, sometimes we think of scripture, well, this is just some sort of history book. It's actually a letter that was written to a young pastor by the name of Timothy from an apostle by the name of Paul. And he writes to him and he says these words. You can read this with me. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first dwelt in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am convinced is in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God. He goes on to tell him that was placed on you by the laying on of hands. See, what he was doing is he was reminding Timothy of who he was. Sometimes you go through life and you've got so many things going on and people pulling on you. You ever feel like you've lost who you really were? You look back and say, man, I used to be so passionate about this. I used to be so involved in this, and I used to be so going. And life's challenges, all the junk that's piled on, feels like it's killed that. I imagine that Timothy has had a lot piled on him. And so Paul begins to remind him that he's got to do something. He's got to begin to take that which is on the inside of him and begin to fan it. Because, you know, it might have been just a little ember that was kind of glowing there. The reality is sometimes we feel that way in our faith. Sometimes we feel like you are burning, and man, you could set the world on fire. You and God could start a revival somewhere. And there's other times where, whew, man, don't even talk to me. Psalm 77, you love to hear the psalmist, and he says, look, when I even hear about your name, my bones groan. That's one of the things I love about God's word. God gives us a glimpse into what folks go through in life. He gives us a glimpse into people who don't even want to hear about God. Gives us a glimpse into to Solomon, who started out absolutely incredible with the promises of God and went to depression. And so you read these books of a man who's in depression. You read Psalms of men that cry out to God and are just angry and fed up and have to come back to God, have to have a reminder to fan into flame that ember that's right there. There's disappointment that you deal with. There's challenges in life. Life doesn't go how you thought it was going to go, and so you've got to begin to fan that into flame. Mothers maybe deal with that more than anyone else. I read a post, and I didn't ask her if I could use it, so I'll just say it's from somebody in this congregation, but a post on Facebook who talked about the unconditional love of a mother. And mentioned that it hasn't always gone the way that you thought. Any moms had challenges in your life where bringing up kids didn't go exactly the way you thought it was going to go? But you remind yourself of that unconditional love. And sometimes, can I share this with you? I mean, the reality of life is we've got to remind ourselves of different things, of focus in our lives. Sometimes we've got to remind ourselves that we love and are committed to somebody. Have you ever dealt with your child and had to turn around, look in the mirror, and remind yourself that you love that child? You pick up the phone, and sometimes you have to say, all right, remember, you love this person you're about to talk to. You're committed to this person. Sometimes that's not just children. Sometimes it's husband. Sometimes it's wife. And you got to remind yourself. Sometimes it's even in dealing with God. Come on. We just kind of get real with this a little bit here. Because the reality is, and a lot of times I know folks, we kind of want to gloss over this. And we want to say that Mom's Day is all about flowers and celebrations and hugs and feeling good. But the reality is, sometimes behind closed door, Mother's Day is about tears and heartache and pain. It's remembrance and loss. And the reality is, the devil wants you to believe that you're the only one that's going through that. He wants to tell you that everybody else is celebrating and smiling, and you're the only one going through a hard time. And I want to take the weapon out of the devil's hands today and let you know that you are not the only one going through, not the only one who is challenged. There is a strength that's found in the presence of God. There's a strength that's found in the presence of His people as we join together and pray for one another and build each other up. But you got to understand something. If we don't admit and understand that each other, that we're hurting, that we're going through challenges, then we never reach out and grab somebody's arm and pull them up with us. We've got to be the brothers and sisters in Christ. We've got to be the family of Christ that are willing to reach out and stand with folks in the hard and challenging times and not just celebrate in the good times of life. Come on, you with me this morning? See, years ago, folks only came to church when everything was going well in life because we didn't want to confess that anything was wrong or difficult or junk going on in our lives. And it's time to blow that mess right out of the understanding of the children of God. And you got to understand that when you're going through your mess, when you're hurting and you're in pain and you don't know where to turn and don't know who to cry out to, that's the time that you got to run to God, not run away from God, but run in with all you got. Because the Holy Spirit is the comforter in our lives. It's part of the role of God. He's here for us, not expecting us to look a certain way and to dress a certain way. Not, whew, you got your church clothes on now. It's Sunday, and so we've got to have with that our church smile. And we've got to say all the right things. And sometimes you get into places where you can't say it anymore. The faking it till I make it mindset just don't do it for you anymore. You're done faking it. You don't even believe you're going to make it. But you're willing to show up just to be there, and maybe God will do something. I want to tell you this morning, if you walked in the door and that's you, God is here for you today. It was more than a song that we sang this morning when we said, God is here. The strength, the power, the grace, the love, the mercy of God. Yeah, it's all here. The comfort of the Spirit. Yes, He's all here. He is I am that I am, and He wraps His arms around us. In those days where you don't feel like you could take another step, yes, He does carry you. Yes, He does lift you up, and yes, He does strengthen you. And it is never, has never been about you being perfect. It's about you reaching out to the one who is and allowing Him to strengthen you, to cleanse you and cover you, to catch those tears and to comfort your heart, and for us to finally be willing to be real with God and not fake it till we make it. How many of you up for being real with God and with one another? I believe it's crucial for us to go on. And so sometimes we've just got to remind ourselves of that. And then when you remind yourself of that, sometimes you got to begin to talk that and speak it to yourself. Have you ever had to talk to yourself, give yourself a good talking to? I want to encourage you. Spiritually, sometimes, and probably on a weekly basis, you just need to give yourself a good talking to. Because you're going to get, and that's part of why you got to get the Word of God on the inside of you, because you don't want to just talk mess. You don't want to talk what other people have gone through. You want to make sure that it's the Word of God that's being spoken to you through even your own words and your own spirit. That's why David said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me, bless His holy name. And then he began to rehearse that God is the one who forgives all of his sins, who heals all of his diseases, who redeems his life from the pit. And so as you begin to recall those things and you begin to speak them out, something begins to happen in your life. Yes. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever walked in church and just really, if it hadn't been for somebody dragging you in or a duty you had to fulfill, you're not sure you would have been there that day. And you got in the praise and worship, and it started going, and you started singing about God. You started singing the praise of God, and something began to change on the inside of you. The darkness and the mess that was there started to dissipate and drain away, and it seemed to almost be a cleansing in your life. Something seemed to almost come alive again in your life. Anybody know what I'm talking about this morning? See, what's happening is, as you're singing the Word of God over yourself. You're singing the Word of God over your mind. You're singing the Word of God over your heart. And here's the good news for you. You don't have to wait till Sunday morning to do that. Come on. A lot of times we think, this is my God part of my life. Sunday morning, I give them from 10 until 12, and if pastor gets done by 11:30, bless God. Yes, Jesus. Felt that hallelujah coming on right there. That's But we compartmentalize our lives. And God wants to blow up your compartments today. He just wants to blow up your compartments to where you're not just God in this little box of your life, but He is through your life in every area of your life. Are you ready to live that with Him 24/7? And so we begin to talk that, and we begin to speak that over our lives. And we recall our motivation sometimes and why we do things, what it is that we focus our lives on. Many of you know this picture of the simply called Prince of Peace, painted by a little girl who had gone to heaven. And there's a story we did last year of a little boy who had gone to heaven and spent time. And as his dad was going through and trying to find pictures of Jesus, he said, all the standard pictures that we would normally think of as being Jesus. But when he came to this one, who was painted by a little girl who had claimed to be in heaven, he stopped his dad and said, Dad, that's him. And so this is called Prince of Peace. And in my office, If you go through this door into my office, that is my screensaver on my, I've got a TV that I use to watch different videos and things through the day. But I put that on, and if you walk in my office, you'll generally see the face of Jesus looking down at you and looking over me. Because, see, I've got to remember that in everything we do, it's not about how well the youth program is going or how well this outreach went on, how many people are in this Bible study. Were these people impressed with the service? It's all about Jesus. Everything we do is about Jesus. When we talk about families, it's about honoring Christ in our families. Moms and dads, let me share this with you, husbands and wives today. When we say the words covenant marriage, covenant takes three. We bring God into the picture. I've said this to you about a month ago, but I want to reiterate it today. The reason that there's a difference between bringing God in the picture and just going down on the steps of county court, the circuit judge. So when you bring God in, there's going to be days where you're not going to feel like doing this for that person sitting next to you. You may be in love with that person and be committed to that person, but there's going to be days that you're not going to like that person. Oh, we're not going to say amen's too loud on that one, but... And see, there's going to be times that you're going to have to remind yourself and talk to yourself that you are not in this for that other person. And you're not really even in this for yourself. You got to begin to understand your motivation and say, God, I invited you into this as part of my life. When I'm raising these children, Father, you gave me these children. Your word says that children are the heritage of the Lord. So God, today, I confess to you that I want to kill this child. But I remind myself that this child is yours. Therefore, I will put away my gun and this butcher. No, that's a... But you understand, you're going to have those days. Things are going to be challenging days. And you're going to have to remind yourself what your motivation is. And it's going to have to be God, because quite frankly, the world doesn't offer a whole lot of hope. You understand? Listen, when I share with you, and some of you, about half of you have been with us for a long time, so you know most of my testimony. Some of you are fairly new. When I was in college and I went through training for counseling, I did a number of different practicums. One of them was a group practicum, a group therapist for teenagers. Another one was a counselor in a juvenile detention facility. And when we were in those and being trained, one of the statements that was there that was just a part of our understanding is that we weren't there to help fix them. And if you try to get involved too much, I've seen a counselor pushed up against the wall and reminded very sternly from our kind of a large burly overseer is we are not there to fix these kids. We are there to help them maintain their lives. In other words, we helped work with a psychiatrist who medicated them enough so they could continue to live the way that they lived, without hurting themselves or hurting anyone else. By definition, we were not there to provide answers or healing to anyone. But see, with God, all things are possible. Nothing shall be impossible with God. And I want you to know something today. The world's way of thinking doesn't include looking at the face of Jesus and saying, Jesus, I've got to bring you into this situation. Lord, I need healing. Lord, I'm believing for my daughter. Lord, I'm believing for my son. God, I'm believing for my husband. I'm believing for my wife. Lord, I'm not believing for them just to make it through life. Lord, I'm believing today, and I'm claiming them through the blood of Jesus, and I'm speaking the name of Jesus over them, that they're going to be delivered from those drugs in the name of Jesus. My son is not going to die. He's going to live. See, when you begin to allow the Spirit of God to rise up on the inside of you, you recognize that the way of the world is not the way that we walk. There's a different highway that God has paved for us, and it's time to walk, reminding ourselves that the kingdom of God is alive. The Word of God is alive in our lives, and it's time to stop living God's Word like it's a
history book and understand it's the power that God's given us. It's a two-edged sword that goes in and divides the soul and spirit.
And in some folks' life, we're looking to kill some of that soul. We're looking to divide it, and I want you to understand that there's going to be times where you in your flesh are not going to feel like it. Uh-huh. And that's where the grace and the mercy of God come in our lives. It's when the power of God comes in our lives, when we recognize that it's not about us, not about our own abilities, not about our own commitments, but it's about God living through us, God living on the inside of us. I want you to know today that the way that you've walked in, the things that you've battled through, the struggles that you're walking through right now, God's plan for you is not that you struggle and battle just till the end of your life. His best for you isn't that you just hold on by your fingernails and make it through. God gave His Son. He poured out Jesus, and when Jesus ascended, He said, I'm going to send you another one that's going to come. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit of God, when He comes and He lives in us, oh my goodness, can I tell you the change that comes in your life when you allow the Spirit of the living God to come and fill your life? He changes your perspective. He changes your vision. He changes the way you talk. He changes the way your actions and your attitudes. God will change everything in your life. It's the incredible thing. When you come to God, He doesn't say, you've got to change and then come to Me. It's come to Me as you are. And when we come, He begins to change our lives. Some of us have given up, and the world wants to tell you that there's absolutely no hope. But today I want to read this scripture and declare it in your hearing. In fact, let's say this together. Ready? One, two, three. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Say it one more time with me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I want you to know something. The world will tell you that getting to know, understand, or love your wife, it is an impossibility. But I want to tell you something. With God, it goes from being an impossibility to being a joy and a delight. See, God's way of thinking is totally different than the world's way of thinking. Some of you have seen the movie Fireproof. I want to play this clip for you for just about a one-minute clip this morning. But it's about a man who is on the brink of divorce from his wife, and it looks like everything is about to be destroyed. And he's doing something that's called a love dare, where he's doing specific things to win back the heart of his wife. Look at this with me this morning.
Day 16 was about praying for her. I kind of skipped that one. Day 17 is about listening to her. 18 is about studying her again.
Studying her?
Yeah, there. And when a man is trying to win the heart of a woman, he studies her. He learns her likes, dislikes, habits, and hobbies. But after he wins her heart and marries her, he often stops learning about her. If the amount he studied her before marriage was equal to a high school degree, he should continue to learn about her until he gains a college degree, a master's degree, and ultimately a doctorate degree. It is a lifelong journey that draws his heart ever closer to hers.
It's a pretty good concept. I never thought about it like that.
So do you study, Tina?
Yeah, but I don't think I got my college degree on it yet.
There we go. Should be on. There we go. When we begin to understand that nothing is too difficult for God, we begin to put ourselves to action. Nehemiah had to stir up the people of Israel this way. He had to remind them when they were being attacked. The people, the Bible tells us, were in fear. But Nehemiah stood and he gave a declaration. Here's what it says in chapter 4. It says, when I saw their fear, I rose and spoke to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. Do not be afraid of them. remember the Lord who is great and awesome. I got to stop and say that to you this morning. See, when the devil tries to rise up and tell you when things are too big, don't be afraid. Remember your God who is great and awesome. See, there's times that you've got to remind yourself of your God. There's times that you've got to remind yourself that it's not just you, your own abilities, but you remind yourself that God is great and awesome. And then it says this, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. You know, just as Nehemiah called to the church and to the Israelites of that day, I believe that there's a call to the church today. Get ready to fight for your family. You battle in prayer. There's practical things that you do. But we live in a day that tells you when the feeling stops, well, just go ahead and divorce her. And I want to tell you this morning that covenant marriage is not about a feeling. Doesn't stop 6 months from now when the feeling goes, a year and a half or 2 years ago when the feeling goes. We stand, and I want to declare to the husbands today, to the wives today, be ready to stand and to fight for your marriages, to fight for your children. For those of you that want to give up on your country, fight for your country. Be willing to stand and go to prayer. Listen, all of this is, in God's eyes, we look at it as being so big. You recognize that God created the heavens and the earth by speaking it into existence. Bible says that he measures it out with the span of his hand. We consider so big, the Bible says nothing is impossible with God. I want to tell you today, no matter what you're going through, no matter what the struggle is in your life, absolutely nothing is impossible with God. Now, when you go through life, I'm going to make these last 2 points, then we're going to pray together today. This is so important because I'm going to take one last weapon out of the devil's hands today. We talked about this just real briefly 2 weeks ago. But so many of us have a expectation of what life is going to be when we first start. Do you remember when you first, the moms in the house, do you remember when you were first a mom? Do you remember the joy and bringing that child home many of you, multiple children home from the hospital? Do you remember the joy and the hopes and the expectations you had? You're a mom now. You and this child are going to be best friends forever. The days, you're going to skip through the days together. It's going to be just an incredible journey of motherhood. They're going to remember all your birthdays and Mother's Days and just want to be around you always. Yes, and you're laughing because that happens in life. And we kind of have an expectation in life as we chart our course and hit expectations that, man, we're going to start low and everything is just going to be an upswing in our life. Man, the course of my life is just, I'm going to get married to this man, and I tell you what, we're just going to walk hand in hand for the next 50 years, and we're never going to say a cross word to each other. He's going to wake up. I saw it in the movies. He said he couldn't wait every day to wake up and just to see my face every day. He couldn't wait to hear what I was going to say every morning when I woke up. And now you married this man, and in his mind he thinks, oh my God, she's talking already. It's 7 in the morning. And somehow your life experience is not the same as Richard Greer and Julia Roberts in the movies. Denzel Washington surely didn't live this and go through these things. And somehow it's changed, and our life doesn't reflect this wonderful expectation that we had in motherhood and in marriage and sometimes spiritually with our journey in God. Because we thought, man, we were going to come in and we were going to grow in God and we're going to get into a wonderful church and we were going to minister in this church and man, we're going to be a part. And I just am, I'm over the moon with excitement in this. And then life began to happen and kick in. And so instead of this type of chart for our lives, our lives look a little more like this. The red line on here where you get the, you start out going up. It starts looking good, man. We're moving in the right direction. And then I found out I have to work with Pastor Francis. And oh, that's a delight and joy. But things begin to happen in your life, and you start out going up, and then it heads in the wrong direction. And then you get back a little bit, and it feels like you get knocked down again. And you're going in the right direction, but it's not that wonderful upswing that you get where everything is walking on rose petals and dancing through the garden where life is exciting. Sometimes life is a battle. Now, I want to tell you this. Some of you are taking notes today. This is a key for life. I'm not a person that puts out tape series that says the seven keys for life. But if I did, this would be one of my top three keys. So if you want to write anything down, write this down today. Life is a journey. Thank you. I'll do that. Life is a journey. See, so many people get sidetracked because they live for the moment. They believe that life is about a moment, and they allow a moment in time to define the rest of their lives. And I'm not just talking about bad moments in life. Have you ever looked at some of the stories? Some of you watch things on TV where they'll say, where are they today? They'll talk about athletes who've won gold medals. They'll talk about rock stars. They'll talk about movie stars and people who went, I mean, they gave so much of their life to achieve that gold medal, and they won. They were in the spotlight on the top of the world for that moment. And they found out a harsh reality that moments don't last. And some people that had millions of dollars at one point in time in their life are absolutely broke. Scrolling through the things that pop up on the side of Facebook this week, and one of them that popped up, 25 top celebrities who are now in bankruptcy, totally broke, because they had a great moment in life, but they didn't understand that life's a journey. Life's not about a moment. See, if you don't keep living that through, keep applying the principles of life, that great moment's going to turn into something that utterly destroys you. Some of the greatest TV stars that you think and you remember different shows of the day that you watch. How many of you grew up watching The Brady Bunch? One of the ones in our lives. There's other shows that you watched, and actors that'll come through. One of our favorite ones growing up was the Beverly Hillbillies. Come on. See, we're dating ourselves now. Some of y'all remember that. But the amazing thing is if you go back and listen to stories from the actors from 15 years past, Max Baer, who played Jethro, lived his life as a bitter, bitter man because he believed that the role of Jethro in the Beverly Hillbillies destroyed his life. They call it typecasting. That it typecast them a certain way. And while we look at somebody who came into your homes every week for over 7 years and in reruns probably for the next three generations, you think, wow, you know, this person made it in TV. They lived for the moment and forgot that life was a journey and thought that this moment was going to carry them through life. On the other side of that, people have had absolutely disastrous moments in life. It felt like that's defined them. Some people have gone through divorce and felt like, well, they're worthless and they can never do anything again. They've been reinforced with that from the church. People have taken one scripture and twisted things around, and there are whole groups of folks where if you've fallen and you divorced, you could never minister again. Now, you might have had affairs with 20 people, but as long as you didn't divorce, you're okay. You know, it's... Yeah, the theology is a little whacked, but, you know, they stick to it. God bless them. But folks all over are in a mess because they don't understand the grace of God in the journey of our lives. And they've allowed a moment to define their lives. And see, here's the incredible thing about God. See, we have moments in our lives that we're proud of and moments in our lives that we wish we could have rewound history so that we would never have lived. But the incredible thing of this is many times God will use your messy moment
even more than he'll use your best moments.
Hallelujah.
See, when we take our lives and when we stop saying, when we look, and can we get real for just say, is it all right to be real for 2 minutes here? Okay. This chart we have right here, this is really all of us. There's not a single one of us who had that chart that just swooped up and never had it up and down. Every single person in this room, this chart reflects our lives in different ways. We've had great days. We've had days that we shudder to even think about. We've had seasons that, man, we felt like we were on top of the world, and other seasons, we didn't know if we were going to make it through. You thought everything was over. No one was ever going to want you. Nobody was ever going to care about you again. But you've got to understand something, that God does not define you by your down times in life. God does not define you by your sin. See, you got to love this about David. God says about David, he categorizes his life, says, this man, remember what he said about his heart? A man after my own heart. See, we look at David and we think, all right, Peeping Tom, adultery, murder, man after God's own heart, is he? But the reality is, if we kind of opened up the book of all the junk that had gone on in our lives, wouldn't have looked real pretty either. Sometimes we look at people who are leaders. Let me turn this spiritually for a moment. We look at leaders in the church and think, man, I wish I could be a man of faith like that. I wish I could have a prayer life like Pastor Francis. I wish I could sing like Pastor Carlton. And, man, you know, we look at people and think, man, they've got it all together. Well, we do. We just don't want to say it. No, it's... far, far from it. In fact, you know what? If you go all the way back to Abraham, the Bible says this, that in Romans chapter 4, and I shared this with you just real briefly the other week, it says this, Abraham staggered not at the promise of God. Man, you hear that? Abraham staggered not at the promise of God. If I just read that one scripture, you know what I think about Abraham? I think of this, man, the dude was awesome. He just lived his life, boom, never doubted God. But then I read the book of Genesis. Abraham went out and got himself a mistress. Had a child out of wedlock. Didn't trust God when they traveled to different areas. So he told everybody that his wife was his sister. She was his half-sister. Yeah. So he was we won't go there, but... He gave her away thinking that the men who it was going to protect his life were going to sleep with her, but at least he'd be saved. But he staggered not at the promise of God. God, you forget a couple things? Here's an incredible thing. We think that God looks at our mess. God looks at our journey and recognizes that it's the whole reason Jesus came. You are never going to be perfect. Paul talked about the journey of his life. He said, it's not that I've attained, not that I've arrived, but I press on toward the high calling, the mark of Jesus Christ. I want to tell you this morning, your life is not about a moment. You're not defined by a moment. Your life is defined by your journey pressing on towards God. It's never going to be said about me that I was perfect, that I raised my kids just perfect, that I never frustrated them, that I never aggravated them, but I pray that it will be said that they know that I love them and would do anything for them, that I directed them to the love of God and to Jesus Christ. So you've got to understand that your life is about a journey. Don't allow a moment in your life to define who you are. Don't allow a moment in your life to define something about you where you say, well, because this happened, I can never. I love when God takes things and absolutely turns them around right now. Do you know that if you go to a crisis pregnancy center and sit and talk with the volunteers there, many of them are there because they've had abortions in their life, and they went through times where they felt
so racked with guilt and shame, but they allowed God to bring forgiveness in their lives. They allowed God to bring healing in their lives and in their hearts, and now they've taken it and they've turned it around, and they're ministering to others with the comfort that God gave to them. They're saying, look, you know what? That was a moment in my life, but God is now, by His grace, using that moment where I thought I was going down. Little did I know that God was setting me up for a coming up to be able to reach out to somebody else. See, some people feel like they're defined because they've been divorced 1, 2, 3 times. That doesn't define you. Your journey defines you. When you put that before God, God makes us clean and says, now I want to use you to minister to somebody else who's going through the pain. Those who've gone through loss and heartache and struggle, God says, I don't define you because you went through a season of depression. I'm giving you grace to come on out of that thing so you can turn around and minister to somebody else. Your moment doesn't define you today. Come on, turn to somebody, let them know, my moment doesn't define me. It's about your journey in Christ. Look what the Bible says. I'm going to begin to close with this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4 talks to us about the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. Listen to this, who comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can comfort those. Let me put that to you again. Listen to this. God is the God of comfort. When you're going through trouble, He comforts you. Why? So not only that you're comforted, but so that you can comfort those in any trouble with the same comfort we ourselves receive from God. Have you walked through hell and back in some areas in your life? Yeah, I probably have. That's all right. Start turning your path towards heaven. God's going to give you grace to reach out and grab somebody else who's walking through that hell and bring them up with you. Don't look down at what you think is a failure, where you think people are judging you. Who cares what people say about you? I could care less what somebody says about you. What we care about is what God has done in you because you've allowed for the grace of God to come in your life. See, here's the difference. You can have a moment, you can have a season where you're going your own way, pulling away from God in absolutely all kinds of mess. Some people stay in it for all their lives and they're defined by that for the rest of their lives. Like I said, with that one actor, they live their lives as a bitter person. Or you can present it to God and allow Him to turn it and use it. Because God says, the comfort that I give you, you're now going to turn around and give to someone else. Many of you sitting right here today, you've gone through very, very hard things in life. You've lost children. We've had many ladies sitting in this place, stillborn children, and the heartache that comes out with that. But God's using you to turn and to pray with others and minister that same grace. And healing continues. The journey of healing continues in your life. God wants you to know your pain does not define you. His grace is what defines your life. The journey of grace. What's your legacy? It's not your moment. It's not your falling. Your legacy is not how many times you fell down. Because Proverbs tell me that though a righteous man falls 7 times, he rises again. If you're in that place where you feel like you've just continued in that season of mess, that place where you've been headed down, and you're ready to turn it around, I want you to know something. Today's your day. Today's your day where we surrender that to God and say, Lord, I need a journey of grace to begin in my life. I don't want my legacy to be that moment. I want my legacy to be my journey. Come on, you've been sitting for a while. Would you stand with me all over the congregation today? Jesus. Your legacy is the journey of grace. That grace is going to be a grace. People are going to know you for the healing that you've gone through, the strength that you've received to walk through those things. But today, I'm believing for some to be absolutely set free. That today, your moment of depression stops. Your moment of shame or disappointment in yourself, it stops. And it's now about the journey of grace. You've identified with those who've missed it for too long. You've identified with Moses when he's missed it. You've identified with David when he's missed it. Forget it. Stop identifying with the sin. For stop identifying with that journey, that moment of absolutely blowing it. Today is time to identify with the journey of grace over your life. That's you, and you're ready for that today. I want to ask you just to join me, just to place your hands right over your heart, because this is about your heart change with God. This is about that time, a season of depression, of shame, of pain ending, and now a new journey beginning where God turns this around. He confirms in you that, first of all, you're forgiven, because you've got to know that you're forgiven. You've got to know that God looks at you through the blood of Jesus. It's not just about you thinking, well, I want to do better. No, forget it. You can't do good enough. It's about the grace of God given through His love as He gave His Son. So the first thing we're going to do is receive forgiveness today. Let's do this together. Would you pray with me? Let's, as a congregation, let's pray together today. Pray this after me if you would. Would you say, Heavenly Father, thank you today for the gift of Jesus. Today, Jesus, I repent of my sin. Forgive me, Jesus, for going my way and pushing you out of my life. Today, Lord Jesus, I turn to you. And Jesus, thank you that you said that if I confess my sin, you are faithful, you are just, you forgive all my sin, and you cleanse me from all unrighteousness. According to your word, I am forgiven. Today, I am forgiven. Today, I am clean. So Jesus, I leave my shame. I leave pain. I leave condemnation. And I turn away to walk towards you. I leave my mess and I begin my journey, a journey of grace. Let my legacy be that I walked with my God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Can we give him praise this morning? I pray that you receive that today, that your moment of shame and pain are over and that you're walking in the grace of God, living a legacy for God. In just a moment, I'm going to ask Pastor Francis to come up and speak a blessing over us, to pray over us as we go out. We want you to know today that we love each and every one of you. We pray that you have a blessed Mother's Day, that a new journey begins in your life. Love someone today and allow God's grace and His compassion that He's poured on you to flow through you today. Amen. God bless you, church.
Hallelujah. Are you excited? Woo. Hallelujah. What a time. Living a legacy. I believe we are going with a loaded blessing this day. Hallelujah. And can you, wherever you are, just lift up your hands as we pray. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. You know, I believe that we need to make this confession as we go. Hallelujah. Say this. I say, in the name of Jesus, I declare over my life that I am more than a conqueror through him who loves me. Today I declare a new day is set for me, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. I take what is mine, whatever the enemy has stolen, my joy, my peace, I take it back. This week shall be my best week in the name of Jesus, because Jesus is Lord. Father, today I thank you, God. Today every weapon of the enemy is destroyed in the name of Jesus. And we declare that our legacy is fruitful, is faithful, oh God. And therefore we say that we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. And also, Lord, we pray for mothers today, oh God, that there is a revival in our soul. There is joy, there is strength, and there is peace. And Lord, as we go out this week, we pray that in the name of Jesus, we stand on your promise and your faithfulness, oh God. That this week, let your favor go before us, oh God. Let every mountain be made low in the name of Jesus. And we declare to every crooked places, be made straight in the name of Jesus. That this week, oh God, let there be a joy in our house, oh God, in our workplaces, oh God, that we will not define ourselves by the moments of seasons of our lives, but we will define ourselves by your word in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for victory today, that our legacy is in you and our future is in you. We thank you for your blessings. Now may the God of peace bless you with his peace. That the God of our healing heal your body. That as you go out, you will go out with the joy of the Lord. And the joy of the Lord shall be your strength. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Let's all shout amen. God bless you and have a blessed day. Happy Mother's Day.